Another day of very intense effort here, and hopefully it's the same with everyone, right? Let's, you know, do the best that we can do and keep on pushing every day. And, it may not be all together just exactly, kind of like my golf game. It's almost there, but not quite. It's close. And we might be this way, you know, from a standpoint of putting it all together. So we've got game. We're really close to having just the spiritual game. One way to get even closer is to focus on the term intrinsic. Intrinsic, you could say, just loving this feeling of intrinsic perfectioning. Wow. Just loving feeling intrinsic perfectioning. Wow. Intrinsic means it's always been there. It's uncaused. It's primary. It didn't become perfect. It's has always been perfect. It's intrinsic. So just loving, feeling, intrinsic, perfectioning, wow. 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 So I practiced that this morning to quite a bit, and it seemed to have great effect. It seems like the convolutions of the defenses of false hope, they seem to be losing their power. That's what it really felt like. Yeah, so when we choose the false premise that reality is imperfect, then the false hope that we can find a way to fix it arises, and then there's all these convolutions arise to defend this false hope and the false premise, defend it. And it's really defending what? Ridiculousness. Is it the ridiculous? Defending the ridiculous is not very fun. Sooner or later, everybody will find this out. There's a lot of people right now in the world defending ridiculousness to a ridiculous extent, actually, right? I'm trying to say, like, how can I help these people? I mean, when I read comments online, I'm thinking, you know, how can these people be helped? That's always the way I look at it. What can I do to help these? And you know, I was like, wow, I'm having a, like, it's like a little bit discouraging. It's like these people are kind of, you know, caught up in the convolutions pretty severely. And, you know, one way we can all be helped is to simplify it all. And Christianity did this by saying we're all sinners. So what they did is they took this whole complex of effort to insist that reality is imperfect and then try to fix it that requires the super convolutions of twisting and turning and distorting and just convolutions to try and defend ridiculousness so we take it seriously. You know, how can we take ridiculousness seriously? Well, all these convolutions, really crazy logic. For instance, you know, here's logical relativism. Here's a great example. If you see, like, one political figure, bad. Okay, we say, that one's bad. And then our logical relativism says, okay, but this is bad, then the other candidate must be good. If I say, wait a minute, maybe this one's bad and this one's bad also, or this one's bad and this one's actually worse, you know. But logical relativists say, oh, no, so this is bad, then the this one has to be good. See, this is a convolution that is, of course, obviously absurd, but it is a way of defending ridiculousness, the ridiculousness of saying that reality is imperfect. As we were full, this effort is just full of writhing snakes, of convolutions, of twisting, and it's absurd to say this is good, bad, so this other one has to be good. We're using so many defenses like this, convolutions, logical convolutions, convolutions of every type. And you see them and you just got to shake your head. You say, wow, you know, this is just absolutely nuts. But of course, defending the ridiculous has to be crazy, nuts. But we're all caught up in this to a huge extent. because we've been really trying to figure out a way, how can we reverse the direction of creation? And we claim that somehow reality is broken, otherwise it could do it for us. We could experience this. No, we can't experience it because reality is intrinsic. The creator comes first, the creation comes after the creator, and not the other way around. The creation can't come before the creator. That's intrinsic. Intrinsic, intrinsic, intrinsic. That means it is. It's the rules of reality. The rules of reality are pretty simple. You're absolutely free, and you can't change this fact. You can't change reality. You can't change the way that it is. That's the rule. You can't change the way reality is. Thank goodness for that. You know, thank the great perfection for that. Because we get perfect freedom, perfect glory forever and ever and ever. And it's, you know, fantastically beneficial to us that we cannot change reality. So, when we drop the effort to try and defend, when we drop the ridiculous premise that reality is imperfect, all these convolutions, we don't need them anymore because we're not defending the ridiculous anymore. They're only needed to defend the ridiculous premise that reality is imperfect. When we exchange that premise for the premise that reality is perfect, no more convolutions. And what happens is these convolutions just sink away, sink into this like huge ocean of smoothness. And you feel this vast smoothness. And you say, oh, I love this. I love this. No more writhing convolutions, you know, like snakes in our mind. You know, it's horrible, right? And so these people in this world now, they're going downhill so badly. It's terrible. You know, look, what are you doing? Do you not realize what you're doing? You're just twisting yourself in knots. They don't see it, you know. They just keep using all these different tactics. So it's really quite taxing to see people collectively losing their minds at this point. Didn't quite used to be this bad, I'll tell you that. Not really. Not at all. You could actually, you know, talk to people and feel like that there's a common ground of flexibility present within everyone. I walked into this kind of an old industrial area today and to pick something up. Huge, huge building. Just, you know, out in a huge industrial area where it's just rows upon rows. You go down the street and just these huge buildings on each side, huge warehouses, huge manufacturing areas. Yeah, that's what it is. That's all that it is. And the railroad tracks going along close by, you know, they pick up all the stuff and deliver all the stuff. It's just industrial, you know, park, you might say, but very large, very, very large. So I walk in this building, and people meet me, and the people were like wonderful there. And I came out of there and I said, what just happened? I felt like I had gone into some sort of time warp or something. I thought I was really like, feel that, you know, what is this, you know, where am I? What happened? What's going on? There's this feeling. I couldn't quite put it in context. I said, what happened? Well, what happened was the people were like, they were like people from the 70s and 80s, kind of. Like you could, they're like, pull up a chair, you know, and, you know, let's visit. And smiling at me, I'm a stranger there, walk in, but there's joking, smiling, and everyone's relaxed. And I haven't felt this for a long time, since the 80s. I mean, it's, you know, it's just the 220s. And yet the way they related was like the 1980s or 70s. So friendly, so defensive. Nobody was defensive. They were so nice. And I was just astonished. And I told some, I said, you know, this is a really, really great company. The people here are really, really nice. And they said, oh, you know, thank you. You know, it's like, it was so noticeable, you know. And I talked to someone else about this. He said he had a similar experience that happened in a certain area also, where people seemed like, you know, they were still living back in that time, and they still had this so friendly and open and non-defensive attitude. People were not competing. There wasn't all this stuff that's going on now. He just wasn't there. Didn't exist. You know, like they just live in this cave, this huge warehouse, and produce stuff, and that's what they do. This person's room was just had no windows, the accountant's office, no windows, and just a desk, a couple of desks, a computer, and that's what you, you know, that's their where they work. It's, I say, you kind of like cut off from the world, and they say, yeah, you know, it's just like, and yet they had this, you like pull up a chair, you're like family, you know, kind of thing. It's like, wow. And you realize how much we've changed since then. How much we have changed, boy. You know, where I live, nobody talks to each other. Everyone's so defensive. Political correctness is why. You know, everyone's terrified they might say something that's offensive or something. But you didn't have any feeling like that with these people whatsoever. There was no sense of like political correctness is not even important. You know. We're just people here, you know. And being friendly and kind to one another, you know. It's like, yeah, that's how it used to be before political correctness. yeah, it's not, you know. There's a whole bunch backstory to all that and where it's going. We know where it's going subconsciously, actually. But what an amazing experience that was. Just say, oh, geez, that's shocking, you know. Wow. But, you know, living back then, it didn't feel that great, you know. It, just in hindsight, you say, gee, it's drastically changed from this type of attitude. So noticeable. I just, you know. They go out of their way to be kind to you. This is unbelievable. I've gone into hundreds and hundreds of businesses and stuff. Never anything like this. So noticeable. I don't know. Maybe they belong to a local church. I'll go to the same church or something. I don't know. But whatever it is they're doing, you know, we want more of that. This is the way Americans used to be. It's the way America used to be. You know, it is not even a question of getting along. I mean, they just... if you felt the love, you know, you're just love. It doesn't matter, you know, what your opinions are of this or that or whatever, you know, there's something, relatability is more important, that we just are able to smile at one another, you know, and be like that. Yeah. The older people, they're not that old. They're middle-aged people. They're middle-aged people. Yeah, middle-aged. Interesting. Maybe in the 40s, 50s, that kind of thing. Maybe even 60s. But holy cow, I said, time warp. You know, how did this happen? So it's still possible, you know. I should go back to what I wanted to ask him, what, you know, what do you, what, how can you be this way? It's the 220s. Everybody hates everybody. You know, I didn't feel the slightest bit of hate there. It's just unbelievable. Interesting, you know. But it wasn't forced. It was not forced. It was just natural, you know. I said, how do I get out of here? They said, go through those doors, walk to that room, and follow the yellow brick road, they said. And so I said, okay, I'll manage. But boy, it was cavernous. You know, it's just like, you kept walking through all these big areas, huge areas and rooms and back, you know, and they're joking about it. And it's just, what a great atmosphere. It must have been religious people. One woman had a cross on, but just the way they treated you, you know, was like genuine, you know, genuine. Wow, they respect themselves enough to respect you, you know. So anyway, getting back to how did the church simplify everything? We have all these convolutions going on. They said, look, we're all sinners. So instead of prosecuting everyone, saying this, you got a million different things going on. They're all bad, all defensive. You're defending ridiculousness in so many different ways, thousands and thousands and thousands of ways, and you got all this familiarity and expectation that that'll be continue to be like this. But instead of saying that, they said, look, just take it that you're a sinner. Okay, everybody here is a sinner, which is true, which is everyone here is clinging to a false premise and defending this false premise through clinging to false hope. Defending the false premise through clinging to false hope, and defending that false hope is, you know, also, we're all doing that. We're all doing that. But instead of condemning ourselves through, you know, tearing ourselves to pieces, you know, about it, we just say, yeah, you know, I am a sinner. There's no question about it. I got issues. I got real bad convolutions, and my expectations are really bad. And I know that I'm addicted to this, you know, and I don't know how to get free of it exactly, except I do know that I do have this very big problem and I need to really work at it. So I just made it really simple for people just to accept the fact they have a big problem. That's all. Wonderful, wonderful, wonderful way to go about it. I have a really big problem, and first step is to admit it, you know. First step is to admit it and recognize everybody else has the same problem here too. Everybody here has the same problem, actually. Defending the ridiculous, period. You know, just defending the ridiculous and defending the ridiculous premise that reality is imperfect. Everybody has the exact same problem here. And when you admit that you have this problem, you know, it takes a load off of you. It takes a huge load, because you don't have to continually be defending. At some point you realize, yeah, I am engaged in ridiculousness and defending ridiculousness, no question about it. But it's a terrible habit, a very difficult habit to break, actually. So then we start being kind to ourselves. I have a big problem. When you realize you have a really big problem, then you start being kind to yourself. Say, well, I got to be kind to myself. Otherwise, I'm never going to get free of this problem. You know, I mean, when you see somebody have a bad, bad problem, or don't you feel compassion for them? Say, wow. You know, you feel kindly to them. Says, well, I really, you know, want to be very kind and nice to you to help you get free of this problem. Well, when we admit that we have a very severe problem, then we start being kind to ourselves. The reason why there's so many people in the world are just hating everyone is they're hating themselves. They're hating the fact they can't find a cure for an imaginary problem. You know, they're hating their insufficiency, the futility. They're hating, you know, they're hating defending ridiculousness, but they feel it's a necessity. They don't want to admit that they have a problem. So they hate the idea of having a problem. They say, no, it's not a problem. I've almost got it. You know, I've got a problem. But when you admit that you have a problem, then you start being nice to yourself. Treating yourself kindly. Says, well, I got to treat myself kindly in order to get free of this problem. I got to marshal my will, you know. I have to build up my willingness and momentum in order to really ultimately exchange the false premise for the true premise. That takes a lot of willingness, a lot of willingness. And we don't have it. Our will is so feeble right now in the world. It is so feeble. There's so much self-hatred and people projecting their self-hatred out on others and hating them, you know, that the will, building up the willingness to look at our problems is really, really difficult for us. And we're very feeble right now. The world is extremely feeble with this willingness, you know, no momentum, you know. So we may look at the world and say, nothing's wrong with the world. It's going pretty good. It's not so bad. But when you lose momentum and you lose the skills that produce momentum, it's a skill set. Producing momentum is an essential skill, and it's a difficult skill. It's doable, but you have to really work at it. When you lose that work ethic to produce momentum towards willingness to exchange the false premise for the true, when you lose that skill set, you're not going to be able to generate momentum very easily going forward. And when you don't generate momentum here, you go downhill bad. and fast. And this is what's happening. So, you know, it doesn't, you know, it takes a little while to show up, but it's starting to show up now, isn't it? You're starting to see it. The cracks are really showing up now, big time. They're getting bigger and bigger and bigger. The cracks in people's psyches, you know, first, you know, you see little hairline fractures here and there. And, you know, some people realize, this is a problem because the hairline fractures are going to start joining one another and starting to get bigger and bigger. And eventually the big cracks showing up, real bad problems. And so this is what's starting to happen. The cracks are getting more and more bigger and bigger and bigger in people's psyches. And they're becoming really kind of psychotic in many ways, badly, badly. This was foreseeable, absolutely foreseeable. Because they don't know how to generate momentum towards the will that they need here. So what happens is they just get sucked, pulled down by their old addiction to, you know, convolutions defending false hope. And they get lost in these convolutions of, you know, just extremely, you know, absurdist logic. And they're lost. They're lost souls. You know, that's nobody wants that. Nobody wants that. On anyone, you know, the idea that there isn't an overarching issue of importance here that transcends politics, see, that just shows you how sick the whole thing is. People should just realize, hey, there's something way more important than politics, which is my sanity, you know. They're sacrificing their sanity for politics, you know, how foolish that is, you know, how tragic it is, you know. Wow. Don't sacrifice your sanity for anything. And don't, you know, so this is a skill set to build up momentum. That's religion helps teaches us the skill set to build momentum towards willingness to exchange the false premise that reality is imperfect for the true premise that reality is perfect. That's all we have to do. It's called repentance. It's called choosing once again. Instead of choosing the false premise, you choose the true premise. That's changing your mind. It means changing your premise. Repent means to change your premise. And so without that skill set, you know, we're psychologically doomed. We're doomed to being really cracked. We call people crazy. They're really cracked, you know, they're cracked. They cracked up. And they used to call them, they really cracked up, you know, mentally. It means they develop, you know, really aggressive psychoses, you might say. A lot of people are living on the edge, you know, of perhaps not non-aggressive psychoses, but the lurking there. It's lurking. They know there's something there lurking, you know, and they're scared of it. Take medications, all sorts of medications. Try to, you know, just hoping, you know. But hoping isn't enough. And then when it gets aggressive, that's when, you can't even describe how you feel, actually, in a negative sense. You cannot. You know, we haven't been mining the psychological store properly in this world recently, to say the least. kind of got entranced by, you know, technology. And we kind of lost sight of, hey, we also have to do the hard work of building momentum. This is something you've got to really... your attention, really have to bring your attention, you know, be aware of your attention and let the play of attention go in the right direction and make sure, you know, you're practicing, you're working, you're focused. You can't just always be partying, you know, listening to the radio, watching television, movies and all that stuff. You just can't be doing that all the time. You're going to lose your skill set. You know, occasionally I listen to an ENIAC, you know, Foon remix. You know, maybe listen to a song or two. Most days I'll listen to a little something. Not every day. And that's, you know, entertainment-wise, that's about it. That's about it. So just, you know, a little bit. But then the rest of the time, it's really work. You know, work here on momentum. So we're supposed to be working on building momentum towards the willingness to exchange the false premise for the truth. That's what we're supposed to do. That's our responsibility here. So we've kind of been we slacked off is what happened. We really slacked off way too much, and now we're paying the price. We're paying the piper. and people are paying the piper bad. But it's just the beginning. It gets worse. If you look at Twitter, for instance, how it used to be, the evolution of the comments, etc. If you look at it, you know, when it's first started, and then the middle of its lifespan so far, and then now, today, for instance, you realize the people, the psyche of the people has just degraded to an extreme extent, actually. It's just progressively like a free fall almost. And now the people's responses indicate an extreme brittleness. That's a type of psychosis, extreme brittleness. Psychological fragility and brittleness. They just can't move. Psychologically, they can't move. They feel like they're just stuck. And when you're stuck, all you can do is just scream and hate everybody. It's terrible. I mean, they feel stuck, psychologically stuck. I understand, been there, done that, all the stuff I'm talking about. I've personally experienced all the, you know, how bad the whole psyche can get, and then how to get free of all of that. You know, sort of guinea pig myself in that way. So, if you can move, you're not going to be all freaked out and hateful and everything, right? You got options. You can move. It's when you feel just pinned down, so psychologically pinned down, that you just can't function. So, you know, the first thing is to keep it simple. The first step is to keep it simple, okay? Really important. You just say, hey, Chris J says, I'm a sinner. And I say, you know, we're suffering from expectational bias. You know, I've got bias. I've got expectational bias. I'm suffering from expectational bias. This is how I usually say it. People reject the term sin because it's just, they're tired of it, that term maybe. So it's the same problem. We can just use a different term, expectational bias. We all suffer from that. That's our huge problem. We expect to continue with this these convolutions of defense systems, all these defenses, convolutions of that are absurdist. We're used to them. And so when we are without them, we say, what the heck happened? I don't know. Whoa, you know, I must be going crazy, you know. You freak out. You think you're going crazy. So you can't just jettison all this stuff and without, you know, you feel you're going crazy, like something, you know, I have no idea what happened. I need to get back to what's familiar. That's, you know, expectational bias is biting everyone severely. So we have to just admit we all have expectational bias, and we need to get the techniques to begin to work on that and begin to, you know, start releasing its grip upon us a little bit, you know, or our grip upon it, you know, easing up on it, ease it up, start generating some momentum techniques. That's essential. So religions really, they teach practicing. I mean, it's homework. I mean, it's schooling. I mean, it's a job. It is demanding, you know. Absolutely it is. You got to do this and this and this and keep working at it. But when you realize you got a severe problem, you're willing to work at it. You really are. So expectational bias is like a prison. It's a horrible prison. And the more we deny this, the more stuck we feel. So these poor people on Twitter, you know, they're imprisoned by expectational bias so badly that you can see there's no freedom in their spirit at all. They're just stuck, imprisoned. It's a horrible thing to see. And other people who are not so much, you see it, and it's a beautiful thing to see that they, you know, they can flow, that they're able to have humor, they're humorous about, laugh at themselves, laugh at the world, you know, be able to, you know, laugh in every way and say, you know, this is ridiculous, this whole scenario is completely ridiculous. It is absolutely ridiculous, this world, this universe, this whole scenario, totally ridiculous. And all the ridiculous convolutions that we've grabbed a hold of, you know, claiming, you know, this we have to do this. It's imperative. God insists upon it. You know, God created us and put us in this world to enjoy. What a beautiful world! And blah blah blah. You know, I mean, while we're all suffering and falling apart and dying, it's just like what? It's completely ridiculous to say such stuff, and you have to start, you know, laughing a little bit at that, you know. It's otherwise you get so serious and you start to get freezing up, you know, you're not able to really make very much progress. So you got to have some chuckle, some humor, laugh at just, you know, the absurdity, the stuff that we've told ourselves to defend this ridiculous false premise that reality is imperfect. You know, we've made up all sorts of absurdist convolutions, and then convolution upon convolution upon convolution, twisted this and that, and then come up with some, you know, belief system like, oh yeah, this is the way it is. You know, So, you know, keep it simple and just start to get a little bit of humor. Say, okay, expectational bias is an issue. Even if I want to get free of something, I keep going back to what I'm familiar with. And if I hear something I don't expect, it's going to cause me a lot of shock. So these poor Twitter folks, I mean, if you say anything they don't expect to hear, they basically go into a psychotic reaction. Look back in the 60s, they would, you know, I'll tell you this, if you were, you know, a psychiatrist in this 1960s and you time traveled to 2020 and you looked at Twitter, you would say these people, the majority of them, said these people are psychotic, incredibly psychotic. You know, but nowadays it's like nobody says anything. It's like, what? That's not good. You know, people are sick and nobody's willing to say anything about it. They're suffering terribly and they're frozen up psychologically. They're psychotic. They're having psychotic reactions. You can't say anything without them just, you know, completely freaking out. It's just unbelievable how bad it is, getting worse all the time. So you don't want to really say anything, you know, because this... having people have a psychotic reaction towards you is not pleasant at all. It's not. It's horrible. You know, it's horrible. You know, it's just that people are not interested in sanity anymore. You know, it's defending insanity that they seem to be interested in. They think they found a better way to defend insanity. They say, let's give this a try. Maybe this will bring about the cure. And, of course, the way to defend insanity is to get everyone to accept an insane premise, and then under the belief that will bring about perfect cooperation, which will then no doubt bring about the cure for imperfect reality. You know, so that's the dynamics of insanity. So they're always thinking, let's go down that road, you know, that'll work. It doesn't work at all. It's horrible. It's horrible. As you can see, these people are again, you, from a standpoint of 1960s, you would say these people are definitely psychotic and having very bad psychotic reactions to what's being said. Because back then, if you responded the way they respond now, you would say this person's psychotic. You know, nobody responds like that. You know, people respect one another. Respect one another's. We all have expectational bias. So of course, we don't expect you to be right. You know. But these Twitter people think they're right. You know. Why should they expect themselves to be right? They're suffering from extreme expectational bias. How can you be right? So the idea, when you say I'm a sinner, you take the pressure off of you having to say that you're right and defend the indefensible. You don't have to defend the indefensible anymore, you see. You say, look, I'm a sinner. I help me. I'm a sinner. I'm working on it. Okay, don't expect me to be right. Okay, don't expect me to be right. I realize I'm obviously off base, you know. This is what Repentance, admitting your sinner, means you don't have to defend yourself, the rightness of yourself anymore. You admit, how can I be right when I'm a sinner, when I have extreme expectational bias? How can I possibly know what is true? I don't at this point. But these Twitter folks are certain, you know, that they know exactly what is true, you know, or are false also. Something comes out and they know, we know that's false, no question about it. Well, how do you know it's false? Because Twitter just banned it. That's why we know. What? How does Twitter know it's false? Because the other news organizations are not reporting it. Well, why are these, so does this news organization not reporting it because Twitter banned it? And then Twitter says it's right in banning it because this news organization is not reporting it. You know, it's kind of like, that's convolutions, is it not? Each one referencing the other as the reason why what they're doing, it must be right. You know, it's like, but is there evidence? Where's the evidence that something's illegitimate or wrong? Oh, well, we don't have any evidence, but we're sure there is some, you know. What? It's called a rush to judgment. It's a rush to judgment. So the rush to judgment these days is unbelievable compared to what it used to be. What it used to be, people say innocent till proven guilty, give you the benefit of the doubt. You know, let's look at this instead of a knee-jerk reaction. Let's get objective people to take a look at this, nonpartisan, neutral, objective people who realize they're sinners, so they realize that they're probably wrong and you're probably wrong, but if we work together, we might be able to get a better picture. At least we can try to get a better picture of it, but we won't, you know, crucify one another if it turns out to be a little bit off, you know, this way or that way, because we realize we're sinners. We're sinners. How can sinners, you know, be certain about stuff like this? So you weren't expected to have a position of certainty and stuff. The only problem is eventually, you know, when you work through your sin, you work through your bias, you do become certain. So if someone comes along and says they are certain, the sinners tend to not like that. So I used to tell people, no, I do know the truth. And they say, now you can't, because we're all sinners. Well, the whole purpose of admitting you're a sinner is to repent. And then repentance saves you from the sin. You're not supposed to remain a sinner forever. So you got to have examples of those who have been saved in order to keep working on it. So it's not like, you know, just saying you're a sinner is the end of it. That's the beginning of it. So they don't quite understand that so well. You know, that's part of being a sinner. You biased against certainty. genuine certainty. And then so people have to, you know, how is it possible that you can be certain? And it has to be expressed in some way that they can relate to. But, you know, we have such a rush to judgment now that well, this can't be right, or this must be right, or this says who, you know? Says who? Says a sinner? You know? Does Facebook and Twitter, they know what's right and wrong? Really? They're not sinners? Gee, that's interesting news. Yeah. They sing like, it's, you know, it's got to be this way. Well, the scientists said this. So scientists aren't sinners? So you mean those who refuse to admit they're sinners, that means they're not sinners? Is that what it means? Is that what we're talking about? No. We're talking about those who admit that they're sinners are much further along than those who refuse to admit to it. And there is a path, a spiritual path, that eventually you find that there is a way to get free of your bias, is exchange the false premise for the true premise. So you're no longer defending the ridiculous. You're no longer defending the ridiculous. When you're no longer defending, when you give up a ridiculous premise, then all your defenses aren't needed, and they subside. They subside, and at that point, you're free of expectational bias. You're free of it. You're free of all of that. So it is possible to, you know, those are the saints. Those are the people who've gotten free of expectational bias by exchanging premises. But they started out as admitting they're sinners. You know, they're biased. Or if they returned here as a bodhisattva or something, then they would have been born without bias, you know, like Ramaharshi or something like that. So you have to also allow for those types of people. But if you don't, is the problem with not admitting to reincarnation is these people cannot accept that anyone can come into this world without being biased. They can't accept that. So that's a huge, huge problem for Christianity, actually. It's caused a big, 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 big mess and problem in the world. Is, let's say somebody comes into the world that they're a bodhisattva, compassionate bodhisattva, a tulku, you know, a lama reincarnating, for instance. Someone reincarnates who's already enlightened, the Ramaharshi, for instance, an avatara, like an Anamayma, for instance. They come into the world already enlightened, so they are certain about truth. They're certain, and the people here will say, "Well, that's not possible. Everyone who comes in this world, they're born sinner. You know, you're freshly minted, but you're still a sinner. But you, so that there's no way to accommodate such a situation in Christianity. It's not possible." And they say, "Only one Jesus is free of sin. Nobody else can be free of sin." Well, that's very incorrect. Very, very incorrect. So Buddhism allows for reincarnations of helpful beings who are free of delusion, who are free of sin, free of expectational bias, to incarnate into the world. And then people recognize them and say, "Ah, so you're one of those. Okay, great. Thank you for coming into the world." Whereas Christianity says, no, you're refusing to admit that you're a sinner. You're bad, so you're one of the bad people because you're refusing. So they disallow such a possibility because they don't believe in reincarnation. So that's really crippled Christianity in a bad way, actually. Very crippling, continues to be very crippling. You have to lower yourself down to their level to be accepted. You know, I have no idea what's right. I'm a sinner. I don't know. Well, that's great when you're starting out as a beginner, okay? But when you've finished and you've repented and you're free of sin, that's not good. You're supposed to say, "I am certain about that." Saying you're a sinner is good. It's a good start. And then helping people, you know, helping everyone go along the pathway properly, you know, help encourage them, etc. So the problem is a lot of Christianity, you know, they don't want to have anyone who's not a sinner around. It makes them feel uncomfortable. Whereas Buddhism is more open to those who are not sinners anymore. They tend to welcome them more. They should be welcomed here. They should be welcomed here. Goodness gracious, if you're trying to get free of madness, you certainly would welcome somebody who's done it and then can assure you that you can do it as well. That's a no-brainer. That's a no-brainer. So, but if you rule out the doctrine of reincarnation, how can you possibly believe such a thing? It's not possible. You'd say, "Well, you must be Jesus then," and you're not Jesus. As long as Jesus already came, and then they think that you're trying to compete with Jesus, or they feel you're blaspheming and all this nonsense. So that's caused by a lack of understanding of reincarnation. So that doctrine should be taught, actually. It absolutely should be taught. If you teach that doctrine to Christians, it's going to help them a lot. Right now, they're stuck. Christians are very, 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 very stuck right now. Because they just disallow, you know, anyone to witness to them that isn't at their level of being that of lack of certainty, you know. Yeah, it's a bad scene. So. That's a reason, one of many reasons why reincarnation's crucial to understand this. I find it very crucial. Otherwise, there's you get an attitude, the Christian attitude they call it. There's a certain attitude of Christians is they're very skeptical about anybody who is not suffering like they are on the path, etc. But what about someone who's already done it in a previous life and they come back here to help? They don't like that. So obviously they're limiting the help that they can get, severely limiting the help that they're open to. You know, they weren't open to that kind of help. Whereas Buddhists are more have been, at least historically, they expect that. They expect perfect ones to be born in the world. See, Buddhism allows for an unlimited number of Buddhas, whereas Christianity says only one perfect person can come into the world, no one else. Whereas Buddhas say unlimited Buddhas can come and help us. So if someone's a Buddha, they say, oh, Buddha, wonderful, thank you for being here. Okay, all right, I'm all ears, you know, that kind of thing. Now that idealistically, I don't know if it's exactly that way right now. I'm not really in touch with Buddhism so much as far as, you know, the way that the religion right now is going on. It's kind of hard to figure it out, really. I'm not exactly sure what's going on. Everything's kind of a mishmash, you know. It's like that. But to be accepted in this world, if you are free of sin, you know, it's tough to be accepted by Christians. Very, very, very tough. They only allow for one person to be free of sin. That's Jesus, nobody else. Pretty much. I mean, Catholics allow, you know, for saints, but only after the saint dies, so to speak, can they really accept it. They don't really accept it so much when they're living, you know. it's kind of unfortunate, to say the least. So when we look at a democracy, the experiment of democracy in the U.S., we can see it's failed. It really has failed. You have tech companies taking over now, basically, and censoring the narrative and telling you what the narrative has to be. You have a breakdown in every which way right now. It's failed. Why has it failed? Because there's nothing strong enough to hold this in check. To hold us in check, you also have an over proliferation of legalism, you might say, and prior to that, religion was held it in balance. Religion held it all in balance, kept it from getting out of hand. There's a certain thing about legalism that it gets out of hand. Because, of course, lawyers make money. Some lawyers. The legal profession is a noble profession. There's a lot of reason for law and order and legal, you know, lawyers to make sure, you know, and make sure the law is followed, etc., etc. But legalism can also get to a situation which promotes turmoil and hatred towards one another. So, and they say, hey, you should sue them. What do they do to you? You should sue them. You should sue them. You should sue them. So this idea you should sue everybody, but lawyers benefit from this tremendously, and they become extremely powerful and wealthy because of this. So they agitate for more and more hatred in the land, more and more divisiveness, more and more combativeness, an attitude of like, you know, you're terrible and I'm going to ruin you if I can. And the way to do it, oh, we can sue you and ruin you that way. And who makes all the money out of that? The lawyers do. So certain kinds of lawyers. So you have to have a check on the law, on legal profession by religion, in order to function properly as a culture. If that check is removed, the legal profession goes crazy. Do you know who are the people in the government now? All these people that are, you know, just unhinged. They're lawyers. You know, they make laws. Those are lawyers. Almost all of them. Trump's not a lawyer, which is, they hate him because he's not a lawyer. You know, it's like you might crack. You know, you might make the people happy. We don't want that. You know, we want them to be at each other's throats. You know, and ready to call a lawyer like instantly. Ah, somebody just offended me. I'm going to call a lawyer right now. I'm going to sue him. You know, that's what they want, actually. And again, let me reiterate, that's a certain type of legalism. You know, not many lawyers are very, very nice, noble profession, and do, you know, great job of what needs to be done in business and stuff. You got to make contracts and all sorts of things and agreements and make sure that people, you know, live up to those agreements and adjudicate stuff. And of course, that's business and commerce and various things. There's a necessity for that. But it's gotten out of hand. It's gotten out of hand in the United States. It's the most litigious place in the world. I had a friend who went to Europe, and he came back, and he says, it's unbelievable. They don't sue over there. You know, it's like the parks are open, stuff. Here, the parks are closed. You can't have anything. You know, there they had all this advanced stuff for the kids, and nobody is worried about the danger about them and this and worried about being sued. I said, are you worried about, like, if your kid gets hurt, you're sued, you know? And I said, what? What are you talking about? You know, we don't sue. We don't sue here. You know, what are you crazy? Whereas in the U.S., everybody's scared of getting sued here now. And everybody's, your whole life is just, oh my gosh, I hope I don't get sued. I hope I don't get sued. You know, what a terrible way to live, actually. So the lawyers benefit so much from animosity among people. Whereas religion is teaching people to be kind and loving and forgiving to one another. That doesn't help the lawyers at all. Where religion's really strong, the legal profession, it's kept in check. It's kept in check. When religion is non-existent, becomes weak, the legal profession just goes crazy. And that's what's happening now. You know, isn't it? It's just lawsuits in every last possible direction, right? It's like, what a horrible, it's a failure. It's a failure. I mean, democracy has failed in the United States. And the lesson to be learned is you need a strong religion in order for any culture to survive. Otherwise, the lawyers will take over. No question about it. It's happened throughout history over and over and over and over and over again. They got rid of Jesus because the lawyers did, They said, Jesus is everyone's going to love one another and, they won't come to us, We can't, they give us all the gifts and, they profited immensely back then too. And Jesus was teaching a doctrine that said, look, nobody's doing anything to you. Nobody's guilty of anything. You're scripting everything yourself. Love your enemy. Be kind to everyone. Forgive everyone. Turn the other cheek. Don't get angry. All these great basic teachings where people, don't sue each other. And, the Dharma, you follow the Dharma, I feel like, I'm totally disallowed from suing. The idea that I would sue somebody is impossible. I would never sue somebody. I cannot, you see. The lawyers don't want that attitude, you see. The Dharma teaches you, you must not sue anyone for any reason. Always realize that whatever happens is your own karma, it's your own scripting that's taking place. It's so, it's not someone else's fault. It's your responsibility, your experience. It's not someone else's fault. Whereas the lawyers are teaching that everybody's a victim. Everybody's a victim. Everybody's a victim. That's coming from the lawyers and the pharmaceutical companies, basically. Keep everybody sick. And again, the lawyers are making all the laws. And you think they're going to term limit themselves? No. They're in charge right now. They're in charge. They're in charge. Yeah. Not a happy scenario. So we need to get back to say, hey, I'm a sinner. I have severe bias, expectational bias, severe expectational bias. So I don't expect myself right now to be correct or right about anything. I need to do a lot of work on myself. So let me get working on that. And I don't have to defend myself as being right or, or holier than thou or anything like that. I got a huge problem, that's that you have to start there. You have to start. So I started in 1978. I realized, wow, got a big, huge problem. And the grace of God said, yeah, but I'll help you all the way through. So don't worry, we'll succeed. We'll succeed. And I relaxed. I said, okay, let's start working on this. 1978, been working on it every day since. Continue to work on it intensely. That's what it takes. And then the whole culture is going to calm down because people won't be all the so self-righteous that they think that they know exactly what's right and you're crazy and then back fighting back and forth and stuff. They'll say, hey, look, we're all sinners here, so let's relax. Most all, there's some that have finally got free of the sin, but by and large, let's realize at least I don't know what the truth is. I'm not certain about it. I'm not going to rush to judgment or to conclusions. I'm going to be loving and kind and trusting, and I'm going to have all these virtues, and I'm going to work on it. Okay? And then, people then are much more kindly. You feel the kindness around people because people are being kind to themselves. They realize, that they don't know. They're not certain. They're confused. They have all these convolutions. The expectations are that they'll continue defending the ridiculous premise, and that causes just unlimited amount of convolutions and confusions and stuff. They realize, okay, and until I exchange premises, I'm still going to be wandering in the wilderness here. And so I'm kind to myself and I'm kind to others because I realize they're wandering in the wilderness also. So religion's extremely important to get this simple declaration and realize, I got a big problem here, expectational bias, really big problem. and that enables, you know, a good culture, you know, a good system to work. Without that, it doesn't work. No system works without that. It doesn't work. It's doomed, you know, it's doomed without that. So the undermining of religion has been extremely aggressive. So many lawsuits have hit religion from every angle, you know. The tearing down, because the lawyers hate religion. Because with religion, how the lawyers are going to, the suing lawyers, how they're going to get money? Nobody's going to sue anybody. Disputes are settled in religious, by religious authorities, and no money changes hands. You see, of course they're going to fight tooth and nail against that. So once the lawyers get out of control, which in the United States, they're extremely out of control, then you don't have a country anymore. You don't have a system that's working. It's broken. It's broken. The U.S. is absolutely broken. There's no doubt about it. People are fighting, you know, really hard to try and get it back. But there's so many people who are far, far gone into psychotic reactions. If you try to say anything to them, you know, they need to confess that they're a sinner. You know, it's the only thing that's going to save them. Actually, it's the only way. You have to, at some point, you have to realize you have a huge problem. It's the only way. Otherwise, you keep defending your position, even though you have an extreme problem. You have to try to appear like you don't have a problem, and everybody else, you know, others are wrong, but you're not wrong, you know, even though you are completely confused. You know, you get caught up in that. It's horrible. So you need, U.S. needs a revival. The only thing that'll save the United States is a spiritual revival. That's the only thing that will save the U.S. And, I, you know, it's unlikely that's going to happen. You know, it could. It's possible. I wouldn't say it's impossible, but it may not happen. And the country may just go down the tubes, and we used to be supplanted by who? The CCP, for sure. China, for sure. No doubt about it. And, yeah. And a lot of people are already, you know, trying to ingratiate themselves with the Chinese and work on their resume so they can present, look how favorable I was to you, you know, and so they can be looked upon favorably once the power shift does happen. But the United States is in chaos, you know, it's gotten completely out of control. And a lot of efforts were made to prevent that. But at this point, you know, spiritual revival is about the only thing that's going to work to help out. You got to keep that humility going. You got to keep that humility going. Got to be humble. Got to be humble and work on your expectational bias. Everybody does. I do every day, have made a lot of progress with it. Still working really diligently on it. It's kind of like my golf game, you know, still working very diligently on it. Still got a little problem, you know. Yeah. But it could click. It could click, you know, like this. It just could click, you know. I'm really tired because I'm doing it every day. I'm so tired. Maybe we'll get a little bit, you know, get bounced back physically and stuff. It may click really nicely. That's quite possible, actually. I expect it to. I do expect it to click. I'm not far off. Just one little adjustment now in my approach irons. I'm gonna have it. I'm gonna have a game. But still, that still has to happen. Still has to happen. One day that's great. Next day they're gone. I said, what happened here? I don't know. I'm tired is what happened. You know, tired probably. But other facets are strong. I believe I can keep them going pretty well. Pretty well. And so it's, you know, looking very promising. But you know, still work. So we're here to work on diminishing our expectational bias, okay, so that we can build momentum towards willingness to exchange the false premise for the true premise. Repent, exchange the premises, right? That's the only way to be saved. It's the only way to be saved, actually. There's no way you can be saved by holding on to the false premise that reality is imperfect. There's no way you can be saved from misery that way. No way. You can go in trance states, come out of the trance state, you still have the same old misery. That's what Buddha found out. And it's very, very true. So you have to accept the true premise that reality is perfect, intrinsically perfect. And we end with in video back going back to intrinsically perfect. Just loving, feeling, intrinsic perfectioning. Wow. So hopefully you feel a little more context now in listening to this video. You say, okay, there is a context of what's going on. It's not beyond recognizing what's going on. Okay. There's some who are able to recognize it, and you know, and there's some who can see it perfectly. Believe me, the spiritual coaches, great spiritual coaches, they can see everything perfectly. And so you can make headway into getting more clear context, and this will be helpful for you. And how it goes the next, you know, as we go forward, wow, too much psychosis going on. So we'll see what happens, right? We really will. And we just have to keep working on our, humbly working on our expectational bias and seeing what it is we really need to do. And getting clearer and clearer and clearer about that. And that's what we're doing here. We're actually doing it. We're doing what we should be doing. And just like working on my golf game, I'm doing what I'm supposed to be doing. I'm really working on it every day. And that's how you finally get it to click into place, actually. You make genuine progress that way. And so even though I feel so tired and terrible, I said, I got to go out and I've got to try some more. I've got to keep, you know, making some headway. I made headway today, hit my 3-wood and my driver both off the tee really, really well, really well. Wow. I said, holy cow, that's a very important thing. And I feel like, yeah, I can keep doing that, actually. I feel I can keep doing it. We'll see. But it certainly feels that way. And alternated back and forth with different clubs and make it really difficult for myself. But I'd go back to the 3-wood and I'd hit it off the tee and it would be really, really good. Long, strong, little bit pushing right, some little bit pulling left, a little bit, but mostly, you know, in the game, you know, playable, very playable, long and playable. Same thing with the driver, you know, quite long and playable. So I said, okay, wow, that's great, great, great progress, actually. And the other stuff, you know, is sort of playable, you know, sort of playable. It'll get better. It's getting close to being in the game of playable, getting close, very close. And tomorrow, maybe I'll probably be after it again. Maybe not tomorrow. Saturday for sure, and Saturday, Sunday. Maybe I'll take a day off, and then Saturday, Sunday, keep working at it. And it's getting dark early now, so it's not a lot of time to get this done. That's why I'm pushing it. And I feel positive results will be forthcoming, absolutely. Just stick with it. So same thing. Just stick with it. Be very determined right now. Just stick with it. Clear context. Be humble. Keep doing your practice. Just love feeling intrinsic perfectioning. Wow. Just keep saying that. Just love.